I will discuss about the struggles between the Polish and German archaeologists, and the fact is that the National Socialism is only one chapter between the clash of the Polish and German nationalism on the background of archaeology. Well, this is just a general introduction, so I will just skip it. I will focus especially about the time before the war, World War II, and during the war, because these are the most interesting periods. Well, we all know these gentlemen, Gustav Kosina, a very important person from the European archaeology, creator of the main supporter of the cultural history paradigm in archaeology. He also put a strong impact to the ethnic relation between the material culture and the ethnic groups, and of course, he was supporting the idea that all the materials that were found in the areas of contemporary Germany and most of the Poland were mean that these lands were prior Germanic and only the Germanic people have the law, the ability to live, to inhabit those areas. But from the very beginning he had opponents on the Polish side. This is Eras Majewski, he's a Polish prehistorian and antiquarian, and he was saying that archaeology at the beginning of the 20th century was too immature academic field in order to make this so tight connection between material culture and ethnic groups. This is Józef Kostrzewski, let's say the creator of the model of the contemporary Polish archaeology. He was the main opposite person, main polemist of Gustav Kosina, and I will talk later about him. But the main thing him that I'd like to mention is that he wasn't, let's say, denying the methods of Kosina, but the results that was saying that some lands were German and some other also German. After the First World War, a significant part of the Eastern Germany was just taken and again to the recreated Poland after the partition during 19th century, excuse me. And among the academic field, originated some Ostforschung, which means the Eastern research, and it was just the aim of German academics to create to prove that they have still the law that the German people should still inhabit the lands of then Poland. And there was answer from the Polish side, which is the Western Front, which is Zachodnia. So it was the main, let's say, the cause of the struggles of the academic field. And these are the four points that were the main, let's say, problems between the Polish and the German archaeologists. And ethnic character of the Bronze Age societies from the Polish area, also phases connected with the pre-Roman and Roman period, with the Goths, with the Vandals, so-called, and the relations between the First Polish Kingdom and the rest of the Slavic groups from the contemporary Germany. And last, the ethnic identity of the first dynasty of Polish kings. Well, Germans were saying that they were Normans, and the Poles were saying that they were Slavs. And I just wanted to present a few figures from the both sides of the, let's say, barricade. So here are the main the main opponents of Józef Kostrzewski and the Polish archaeologists who support the Kostrzewski fault. This is Borkover Richthofen and Ernst Petersen, both later involved very strongly in the National Socialism, and Richthofen was a member of Gestapo, Ernst Petersen, member of SS, and the Arminenbe also. And on the other hand, we have Professor Leon Kozłowski, also a very important person, an archaeologist. Besides that, he was a very influential Polish politician, he was a prime minister. And what's important, he has a very pro, let's say, German view on both on the politics and on the archaeology. And example of two maps. First map is made by Professor Jarzewski. I will later tell more about him. And it's from represent the fourth period of Montelius Bronze Age chronology. Here we have the Lusatian culture, which was in him treated like a Slavic culture. Here we have Celts, Illyrians, and the Teutons somewhere on the north. Here we have another map of Wolfgang Babler, who before the war was the director, inter alia, of the Provincial Museum in Gdańsk, before the First War. And this is a later period, early Roman Age, and suddenly we have here Ostgermanen. This is the early Iron Age, so it's Pomeranian culture, which was connected in the Labame and also Ernst Petersen, about who I mentioned before, in a strike line with the Ost Germanic tribes. So the Slavs from the earliest view that I showed you just disappeared. So the maps, from the point of view of the ethnic identity, were totally different. And here we have examples of archaeological sites that were excavated during before the World War II. And this is a famous Biskupin bronze, late Bronze Age settlement, which was used in a very frequent way by the Polish archaeologists, by Kostrzewski, in order to create, let's say, this to prove the Polish ability to inhabit the Polish land. They were making a kind of propaganda, inviting very famous Polish people. These are the hierarchs of the Polish Catholic Church, which was very influential, actually still it is. Here is the primate and the Archbishop of Krakow. Kostrzewski is in the middle. And here we have Marshal Rudzinski, the second most important person after the president, just before the Second World War, the commander of the Polish army. And well, because of him, we lose the September campaign. And it was much more of famous people, like also President Ignacy Mościcki. But also there was some contacts with the German scholars. We can see here the director of the museum in Museum of History in Berlin, and archivist from the State Archives in Berlin. With Polish archaeologist, also Professor Kostrzewski there is. So there was some context in the more friendly manner, and what is more, the Polish were also, at least in some way, basing on the German methods of making researches and of making a kind of propaganda. And the second site, Altkreisburg in Eastern Prussia, here is the location, so it's quite close to the German border, to the Polish border, and the aim of this excavation was to also to prove that this area was proto-Germanic, because they were looking there for the materials of the available culture. Later it was put aside, and also the all the history connected with the Teutonic Order was fighting with the Balts from that area. Well, the two main researchers of this site, Hans Schleif and Wolf von Sippert. Well, there was on some others. It's worth mentioning that they were involved right in the Annalerbe, and they were members of SS. Later Schleif moved to Biskupin, and of course they invited a very, let's say, important person of the time. Here we have a Heinrich Himmler, looking in a very friendly way, visiting the Altkreisburg, and Schleif was complaining that they have problem with transportation, so they have received a gift, a diamond lens. A lot of young Polish German people were a member of the Jugend, so they were learning all this history, what their ancestor made, what they create. And these are another important figures, so maybe I will skip them because it's not so important. And at the end, just before the beginning of the World War II, the I think quite well-known citation of Hitler, who was complaining why does Himmler is exciting so much the things that archaeologists do. They are digging and finding that proto-German people were living in the mud huts in the same time when the Romanians were spending their time in Colosseum. So what's the reason? And we have an extremely important turning point, invasion of Germany and the Soviet Union on the 1st of September 1999. A new order, the land of Poland, at least before the 1941, was divided between the Third Reich and the Soviet Union. And it was a big different situation in the central Poland. It was the general governor when we would see the Polish institution have some kind of autonomy, but from the rest, like for example the Poznań Museum, where Kostrzewski was director, was totally removed, and the German authorities were put there. Just to show you that this is a map from this period, and it's a city where I live, Gdynia, and the proper name would be Gdyngen, but Germans call them Gotenhafen because there is an eponymic site of the Occitan culture, which is the pre-Gothic culture, and they thought that it would be good to change the name of the Gdynia to the God's Landing or something like that. This is very ridiculous. Okay, and Kostrzewski was forced to hire, this is his false identity. Well, in general, Polish archaeologists have very big problems, and he was chasing, especially by Volkov and Richthofen, who was a member of Gestapo. Later he was saying that he was just had to protect Kostrzewski. And, well, excavation in Biskupin conducted now by the Germans, Hans Schleif was the leader. This is one of the visits of the high rank Kriegsmarine officers at Wehrmacht. They're trying to, well, to do the same that Poles were doing before the war, but in the opposite direction. And interesting thing what happened with the main archaeological museum before the World War, because it was, well, the main director was removed, but the Germans allowed to work still under the authority of Konrad Rzeszewski, the main, let's say, pupil of Józef Kostrzewski. So they were part of the materials were removed from the museum, and some of them were left, and the Germans were ordered from time to time to conduct an excavation for the Polish archaeologists, and later we just obligated to send the excavated materials and summarized about that to the German researchers who were publishing us under their own name. And but the fact is that Jerzewski saved a lot of people because by giving him them a work in the State Archaeological Museum, he gave him a proper identity, so the Germans couldn't, for example, put them in the concentration camp. Other archaeologists don't have enough luck. And this is, Polish journal, the most important Polish journal that was confiscated because examples were in September printed and waited to colport to the rest of the Polish institutions, and this number was devoted to Józef Kostrzewski. So most of the supplies were just destroyed by Germans, and about 50 of them survived. They removed the part of Kostrzewski. They wrote that the Germans wrote that it would be the last number, and so. And they said that they just saved these 50 examples because there was a possibility that they would be destroyed. And instead of that, we have the book Zeitschrift, the journal, which was printed by the Deutsch Institute for Deutsch Ostarbeit in Krakow. It was an institution hiring, made by Germans, but they hired also a lot of Polish prehistorians, and they need to work in order to give a proof that these are pro-German lands. And the results of excavations conducted by the State Archaeological Museum, the Polish archaeologists, were published there. Here we can see example. These are the excavations east from Warsaw. The Luftwaffe was building a new military airport in order to support the invasion of the Soviet Union in 1941. And they found some materials from the Roman period, so it was and the pre-Roman, so it was very important for them because they were Vandals, gods. So they told to excavate all this area by Jerzewski and his people. They excavate these materials, typically from the pre-Roman and Roman period. He sent to all the materials after excavate and proper signing them. They sent them to Werner Redig, who was boss of the prehistorian section of this institute in Krakow, and he published them as his own work. And Jerzewski was mentioned only two times as in the footprints. A very interesting example, there was Kamil Niedziółka, who was a before war prehistorian. He was put just after the beginning of war in the concentration camp in Mauthausen-Gusen, which was the most, let's say, most dangerous, I don't know how to say it. That just the average length of life in this concentration camp, it was about 3 months, and they left there for the 5 years because the commanders of this concentration camp, Cyrus, knew that Hitler's were interesting prehistory, so he decided that it would be good to have an archaeologist who would dig, and well, later he also These are the excavations. People in the striped clothes work here, so this is just a madness, I would say. And these are his results. He organized a museum in one of the concentration camp barracks and account. Also, once also the Himmler visited him, and Galinek was ordered in 4 days to prepare a very comprehensive monography of all the materials. And he was just forced because he had the help of the dude. And in the gas chamber, so this is something which is really hard to imagine. And these are the commander of Mauthausen Gusen and the commander of the Gusen Philip. These are quite well known from the historical sources of the Second World War. Persons committed a lot of war criminals, but this was the kind of people who were interested in history, and everything because of the Hitler interest in the prehistoric, which should give the proof to pro-Germanity of Polish lands. And just a quick brief that before the World War, the Second World War, there was about 50 active prehistorians, 21 died, I mean, was murdered or other, and 12 was arrested, this at least because it could be more of them. The Polish institutions and museums were looted or closed, but let's say that still at least the ones who were able to survive during the time were working, and what was interesting, they were creating the works, the contributions that were improving it. The things that Germans find is not true, let's say. And what happened? Well, with the one that I mentioned, in Hans Petersen fell on the Eastern Front. Hans Schleich, this is a very good history because, well, like Goebbels, he just committed a suicide. Before that, he just killed his twin babies and his wife. Well, other survived, and we can see Sifon just moved to the Iceland, changed his name, von Richthof, and this is a very, I think, controversial because he moved and later to the Western Germany, and he was still making the same stories, and he was even ordered, and similar history with Reddy, but I would not like to punish him because this is a person who worked in two different totalitarian systems, and later he met Jarzewski in one of the conferences after the war, and he asked Jarzewski what do he think about his activity, of the Reddy activity in this institution of Krakow, and all the stuff connected with the prehistorian. Just Jarzewski answered him that okay, it could be much worse. So this kind of idea. Okay, this is just after the war. So just after the war, there was another eastern part of Germany was put into Poland, to the Polish border. So there was also quite important for the Polish archaeologists who survived the war to improve that these are the Polish land, and it was quite famous in Poland, 1000 year anniversary of the Polish state, of the baptism of Poland. So they decided to conduct a lot of excavation who would support this idea. Here you can see excavation conducted by Jarzewski, who was, he needed to leave Warsaw because he was accused of some of his, personal enemies because of his, cooperation with Germany, which was not really true. He conducted excavations in the Gdańsk among the ruins, so it's also shows a lot. And another excavation, okay, it's not so important. And his cooking was another time using the political purposes, in this time by the communists. And in the 70s, some political climate between the Western Germany and Poland changed because the Western Germany finally accepted Polish borders, so there was no need of making this kind of nationalistic, researches connected with the Slavic presence on the Polish border, so it was not so problematic. Even some kind of strong of, autochthonic tendencies, the theories supported autochthonic presence of Slavs and the late common Slavs on Polish lands appeared, and And to sum up, we can see this quite brief history of Polish-German struggle. Likely now it's a much more friendly atmosphere, and the relations are based on the common projects. And a lot of Polish students go on the excavations in Germany, and also in opposite together with the Polish archaeologists and professionals. So I think that it's a kind of, well, a lesson for the future, I think. And thank you very much.